everybody? Hello. Very low energy. Let's try it one more time. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
All right. This is REI Vietnam, Hanoi University, my first ever lecture, so please bear with me.
First of all, let's introduce our group. My name is Tang. This is Ian. This is
Chai.
This is also Phuong. Okay. So today we'll be talking about some of the economic charts that was provided here. So let's start with the first one, the total number of employment in USA. So our graph starts in 2001. And it started with the end of the internet bubble, where the total number of employment was 133 million. And this is where the internet bubble burst, and the U.S. started into the recession period, and the number of employment dropped to 131 and 130, and stayed around there for 4 years. Until getting back up to 130 in 2005. And this is the start of the housing bubble. And with the housing bubble, the number of employment rise up again to 138 million at the end of 2007, when the financial crisis occurred. And it just dropped by 8 million in 2 years. Yeah, 2 years. To the end of 2010. And here, this is the period of the Great Recession. And here, with the implementation of the zero interest rate policy and the quantitative easing, the number of employment started picking up again, but it took them 5 years, from 2010 to 2015, to back up to the normal level. And this whole 8 year period is called the new normal. And from then on, after they get back up to the normal level, the economy just get normal again, normalized again. And the total employment go back up steadily to today where it reached 151 million. That's all for this slide. Okay, on to the next one.
So I'll talk about the total unemployment in the period from 2000 to 2018. The statistic was collected by Bureau of Labor Statistics, and okay, start with the year 2000. After the internet bubble and the regression came, the number of people who unemployed was 5.4 million. And due to the recession, it started to increase. And as the housing bubble came, the number of people unemployed declined. Until the financial crisis, it started to rise again until the Great Recession. It hit the peak of 15 million. This is the hopelessness time for the economy. This is in 2009-2010. So as the Fed introduced the zero interest rate policy and the quantitative easing, the number of people who were going to work started to increase. So the number of people unemployed declined. And it hit 7.8 million in November 2016. And due to the trade war, which was introduced by Trump, the number of people unemployed declined to 6.2 million in 2018. So that's all about my part. Let's go to the next.
address. Okay, so starting from the internet bubble, the job hiring rate have at first it has a number of 5.3 million, and then it's under the recession it also increased to figures to nearly 4 million, and it happened until the housing bubble, and in this interim period it started to decrease again back again to 0.6 million until the financial crisis, and in this period the job openings also decreased due to the financial crisis to 2.2 million in great recessions, and in this period from 2009 to 2030 there were the period a name called the new normal, and then under the zero interest rate policy and quantitative easing, the job openings started to increase again back to 4.6 million, and now it also increased, and because of the trade war that Donald Trump made in 2018, it also hit a peak of 7.6 million. Okay, that's all my part. So link it to the next.
This chart is compare the unemployment rate, which is the red line, and the job openings, which is the green line, as you see here. So we start at the recession time. As you can see, that is a very little slow gap between the employment rate compared to the job opening. However, when China joined WTO, I guess because it have globalized, and therefore many companies decide to outsource the process. In starting here, you can see that there be more unemployed employee, and the job also decreased, and this gap became more larger, and during the housing bubble, even though then this gap also lower a little bit, but you can see that the increase in the job opening cannot meet the demand in of the unemployed employee. From at the end of 2007, the Great Recession appeared, so it led to the significant rise in the unemployment rate, and it peaked at 50 million unemployment people. Meanwhile, we can see that in here the job openings hit the lowest point with 2.2 million job available. So this gap means that there's around 12.8 unavailable job to meet the demand of people at the time. Next is under the control management of Barack Obama and the policy zero interest rate policy and quantitative easing, this economy start to recover. We can see the decrease in the rate of unemployment when job openings start to rise, and now we got at the end of this timeline, under the trade war that government of Trump imposed, we currently have around 7.3 million job available, which is larger than the rate of unemployment, 6.2 million. So we can conclude that there are now more jobs available than the unemployment.
Okay, now I will continue. The wage growth measure the nominal wage growing rate, and I think I will divide this recession into three periods, in the recession period, the recover period, and the fluctuation period. First, in the recession period, the wage growth decreased in start when the financial crisis occurred, and in the recession, it reduced from 4.2% to 2.8%, and it reached the lowest of 1.9%. In the session, in recession period, the less people will hire and the less wage they will pay for the job. And after that, in the rural, zero interest rate and quantitative easing, the government want to recover the economy. They want to raise the GDP and open the production. So they will raise the wage growth from 2.1% to 3.5%. The second period will last from 2010 to 2016. And after that, the final period is from the Trump president. Want to raise the wage growth from the 3.5% to 3.9%. And this period, the growth have some fluctuation, but I think that it will remain around 3.9 to 4% after that. And so the last part,
okay, so I'm going to talk about the consumer confidence index. First thing first, the confidence index talk about the confidence about the current state of the household toward their confidence about their current job and business. So we can see that the main pattern here is fluctuation. And in the internet boom, the high peak is 143, and in the housing bubble, the is slightly smaller, which is the 110. And then in the financial crisis, we can see a sharp drop here, which in the financial crisis, all the jobs have been killed, and the job and the confidence of the household is lowered down to the 27. And in the new normal of Obama and Trump, you can see that they are rising pardon, and the confidence in state was raised. And we can see that Trump inherit the rising pardon, peak rising pardon, and the confidence in state raised to 131. Let's bring our first to the end of the session.
Really wonderful, but to stay on time, let's get this team on. Okay. Don't wait your time. 1 second.
Okay. Okay. So we are gonna start our presentations, and my name is Cheese, and these are my partner, Hi, Hui Minpu, and Miss
Jill.
Yeah. So first of all, I'm gonna talk about the total employment in the U.S. Right? And you can see, around this time, started 2001, the internet bubble, and then after that, every bubble got the breaks, right? Got the breaks, so it reduced like around up to 131 in 2002, and after that, the number of employees start to recover back to up to 138 after the housing bubble, because more people have more faith in the housing statement and such. And well, it start to reduce again during the presidency of Bush. We got the financial crisis, and because of that, it reduced going to the period of 130 at the end of the presidency of Bush. And this is the great recession in the US. And well, after that, we have Obama as president, the new president. strong again. And at the end of Obama presidency, we got Trump, and he thinks that the economy is is so strong now. He start the trade war. We have to increase more and more to the total employee of the U.S. So that is for Trump. Have you talk about the unemployment?
So now let's come to the second slide. It's about the total employment in the U.S. I will talk about the period from 2001 until 2018. And let's start with the first year. It started with 5.4%. And it's also considered as the lowest rate during the period. And according to the internet bubble, and the U.S. begin to go into the recession. And next to the housing bubble, with the fact that people invest in ABS and CDO, so it leads to the financial crisis. That is a time the unemployment rate is 7.2%. And the next period is called Great Recession, which team 2 years from 2008 until 2010. It's the unemployment rate double until more than 15 million. And it's called Peacock Listis. That means people, they so hopeless. And also the next period, people more confident and they hope to have more job, more the economy is recovered, so the job will be better for them. And also the Barack Obama has introduced the zero interest rate and quantitative easing, so it helps US to increase more job to reduce the unemployment rate. At the end of the Barack Obama term office, and in 2016, the unemployment rate end at 7.9%, and it will reduce more in the next term of Trump. And that is the end of my part. So the next slide will be presented by Lin.
Okay, so I just tell you about the total employment. Three, which is the total unemployment rate, and 17% for U6. This is the period of Great Recession, and this is the period of currently statistic, which is the period of Trump as president. It's discrete a lot, but I pay attention for the gap between those. There is always, it seems to have this constant gap between these two, no matter how up and down it is. They always, like U6 always almost double the U3. So I think one of the reasons may be that there are more job requiring less skills and knowledge than higher level one, which is require higher level skills and knowledge. Even you can see that even in when Trump do this, the economy is grow fastly and highly, so the unemployment rate go down too. But then there's still 7.3% of people which who unsatisfied with their job, which is double the level of unemployment rate. So that's all about these two lies. I hope that you can understand. And now will be the green part. Okay. So this is about the job openings. So you can see that the job openings, the job openings rate has a negative relationship with the unemployment rate. So started by the Department of Labor in 2000, the job openings is in 5.3 million jobs, and because of the internet bubble, it's decreased during the recession time, and then it's started to increase again thanks to the housing bubble and reach 4.6 million. And after that, because of the Great Recession, it's decreased dramatically to 2.2 million. And then from 2006 to 2014, thanks to the zero interest rate policy and quantitative easing, the job vacancies is increased again and reach 4.6 million. I think the reason is thanks to is because Barack Obama brings hope to people and is creating more jobs. And then during the trade war years, is increased dramatically and reach 7.6 million. And it's about the job openings, the vacancy, job rates. And next is about the answers.
So my two friends have described about the job opening and the total unemployment. So this is a joy diagram of these two lines. So I want to concentrate more about the comparison. So at this point, the China joined WTO, so that means less, like China have to, Chinese can work for more labor for the US company. So the total employment increased a little bit, and but then it's not very stable. So the total employment decreased like gradually till the financial crisis. In the financial crisis lead to the Great Recession, so the total unemployment in the US peak at 15 million of people do not have a job. After the Great Recessions, like thanks to the government policy of quantitative easing and zero interest rate policy, and is in this policy, it encouraged end of the presidency of Obama, and then Trump. And Trump's trying to come to do what he has his slogan, make Americans great again. So he started the trade war with China, to make the people, US people, to march out for US people. And like in my opinion, like they're due to the extreme policy of not make the Mexican and other Americans, American citizen, like Mexican, they try to make them hard for them to work and live in America. So that means more job for Americans. And at the end, till this moment, there are more jobs as 76 million jobs than people to fill them, that only 6.2. So that's the end of my part, and we use the same part to buy the job.
Today we will talk about the wage growth tracker, and this comes out of Atlanta, the federal wage growth tracker. This is not my area of expertise, so I feel like I will bring more questions that perhaps I would ask as I look at this graph. I think my team has already talked about the timeline and some of the politics involved. One of the questions that I would have, okay, we can see you can go from 4.2 down to a low of 1.9, and we've already talked about the recession and then bouncing slowly back. But one of my questions would be, so it's the feds, as we call them, the federal government and the politics behind it, that will fix our minimum wage. So the lowest hourly wage that we can have. So one of my questions would be, I'm not up on all the policies and these individual people who have helped to set the minimum wage, but that has had a huge influence. So if they are optimistic or want to drive the politics in a more positive direction, they can increase the minimum wage. So if I were to continue, you know, because it looks a little bit boring in a sense, but I think there's some very significant information to be derived if you press into this. One of the other questions I would ask, our wage is determined as well by our employers. And so you have to not only look at the optimism or the confidence that the employed person has, but it is the employer that is going to be really driving this back up. So there would perhaps be some statistics about the employer. And part of that, I feel like what I can bring is that I'm an American. So in the insurance industry plays a huge part in this, and Obama's policies and Trump's policies in the whole health package, because an employer has to provide a certain health package and benefits package, and that will determine how he feels about increasing your salary. And so with the Trump administration, he was really on the side of the employer, whereas the Obama was very much on the underinsured. But this played a huge role in what was happening with our salaries, okay? How the employer felt about increasing your salary. I feel like there could be some very interesting information added to this to make it a more interesting graph. So I feel like it's an interesting beginning, but I feel like there's kind of dynamic forces politically happening this way from the feds, and then call it from above, happening from the employer. So that's.
Thank you very much. Okay.
You can see the overall trend is increased from 8.7 to 11. And you can see there's kind of some peak here, and here. And I do believe that because when the foreign country investing into our industrial production, the government give the incentive to give, you don't have to pay tax when you invest in our country. So there is a peak there, but after the year, the incentive gone, and so the production kind of stabilized now. And during the years, you can see there are a little peak here because I believe because of the TPP, TPP Trans-Pacific, from Obama, and so the production kind of increased. But however, when Trump got into the become the president, he kind of break the peak TPP, and so it's kind of slower a bit, but we are still stabilized in the industrial production. So that's all for the industrial production chart. And move on to the GDP.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
The real GDP in Vietnam, first of all, is quite low for the long period. Like it have increased and decreased, but in general, it remains quite constant, and the fluctuation is not so strong. The reason for that low real GDP, there's two reasons, I guess. The first one is because the economy of Vietnam, like nowadays there is more and more startup and business in Vietnam. Like people have more awareness about startup and start doing business, so it can help the economy. It's raised from 18% of people having the idea of startup into 22%, but it's still a very low number compared with other countries and other developing countries. And the second reason is about the inflation and the GDP growth rate. The GDP growth rate is quite high recently, but it cannot beat the inflation rate, inflation growth rate. I have some statistics here. Sorry, we didn't have enough time to compare and go to the conclusion, but in short, it's the reason of the low economy, less people think about startup and business, and the second reason is about the inflation rates. So now it will be the part of you guys come in. Hi.
In 2011, we experienced the hyperinflation, and the reason is that in 2008 there was a great recession in the U.S. and in 2011 was the is because of the Asian recession, and that recession was resulted from the Great Recession in the U.S. Other than the two hyperinflations in 2008 and the 2011, the consumer price inflation in Vietnam is quite stable, and in 2012 is decreased from the peak of 2023, so to 9.3 and then 6.6 and then just stable below 5, and in the last 2 years the consumer price inflation is stable at the number of 3.5. So that the end.
Okay. So we are going to present about the industrial production of Vietnam, and the industrial let's first talk about the industrial production. It contains the following industries: mining, manufacturing, electricity, gas, and water supply. And here we have data from 2011 to all the way to 2019. And now, first of all, we can see that the number fluctuates, but stay relatively close to around 8, from 8, 6, 9, 6 again, 11. I think it is very normal for a developing country. And second, the second point of interest, let's look at this. Up, 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 up. And all of them is around March. And I think that this is because the executive push for production at the end of a fiscal year.
Oh my God, Kathy.
And I think that is why we have these sudden bursts of production. And another one is around 2017. Here, all the numbers are pretty high, 10, 11, for 2 years. And I think it's because of the CPTPP, which is... let's just say that it is CPTPP. And I think that is why production was up, because of the prospect from that policy. That is all for now.
You want to talk about the consumer price inflation? So as you can see that we start at 8.3, but then in 2007, but in 2008 it rocketed to 28.3. This happened due to the reasons that in the first six months of 2008, the price of all the goods in Vietnam started to rise, because due to the care about the quality of the food at the time, especially for the price of the rice in Vietnam, that pushed the price of these goods increase higher. But the government then they have policies to reduce the price. Therefore, in the last 6 months of 2008, you can see that this line decreased, and in 2009, it's just only around 2.0. This happened because the influence of 2008 was too strongly, that people still worry about the inflation will seem to rise in the next years. So my partner will continue for the last part.
Okay, so you can see that in 2012, the consumer price inflation rate reduced to 5%. Because from the 2012 to 2014, according to the news, the news I have read is that at that time the central bank had began to conduct flexible monetary policy with the view to to achieve the macroeconomic stability, and in 2015, the consumer price inflation reduced to least point to 0.6, because that in 2015 is a result of the plentiful supply of grains and other food, also the sharp decrease in some transport and utility costs, and from that period to the end period, it remains stable to and low consumer price inflation. It can create more condition for the expansionary monetary policy.
Yeah, so you can see from 1992 to 1996, there's sharp rise, and we think the sharp rise is explainable by the fruitful result of the reform that started in the 1986, and
one more thing that can be noticed is that in the 1992 to 1996, the America that start openly relate have a relationship with Vietnam, and that make the GDP go high to this point. But in 1996 to 2000, we are searching on the internet, and it say that the GDP, the nominal GDP, is really high. But we can see that in the real GDP chart here, it is quite low and is experienced a sharp drop, and it can be explained by the inflation rate, which is confirmed when we're searching it online. And it's from 2000 to 2008, you can see a stable pattern.
Now I will continue. In 2008 and 2012, we can see that the real GDP decreased. At this point, because in Vietnam, Vietnam is affected by a financial crisis in 2008, and the recession economy in Vietnam in 2012. After that, Vietnam government have issued the monetary and fiscal policy to recover the economy, and the real GDP grow steadily, and according to my knowledge, in 2018, the GDP of Vietnam is about 6.6% growth rate, and the government will make the growth rate constantly while they take the effort to control the inflation rate around 3.2% according to curious line.